Good afternoon. I welcome you all to this webinar on curriculum for mental health. For more light on IT media mentoring books, please subscribe to our page to get regular updates about our webinars. This webinar is being organized by IPWC Satara District of Maharashtra State and in association with the Krishna College of Pokhara. So now I ask the organizers to please start the session.
There are some disturbance, I think.
Yes, sir. I think it's sorted now. Good afternoon, one and all. We welcome all the participants to this webinar series. It is webinar 3, day 2 for the webinar series, which is jointly organized by IIP Women's Health Satara District, Maharashtra, in collaboration with Krishna College of Physiotherapy, Karan. For our third webinar of today, we have with us the renowned speaker, Dr. Snehal Deshpande. We welcome you, madam. And the topic for today's presentation is Toolkit for Developmental Delay. Before starting the presentation, I would like to introduce IIP Women's Health. IIP Women's Health was started on 30th of May 2018. It functions under the guidance of National Head, Dr. Ruchi Varshney, and IIP President Executive, Dr. Sanjeev Jha. IIP Women's Health worked towards conducting public awareness camps, CME and workshops. It aims at bringing together all physiotherapy professionals for sharing knowledge and improving public awareness about physiotherapy. We have 5 zones in India with the heads of each. For the West Zone, we have with us Dr. Pooja Kamble. For the state team of IIP Women's Health Maharashtra, it has the state coordinator as Dr. Suvarna Ganveer, state joint coordinator Dr. Snehal Patel, sub-coordinators Dr. Uttara Mohan, Dr. Priya Karande, and Dr. Nirali Sangvi. Maharashtra State has conducted 40-plus low-cost activities in various districts and N number of webinars in the past few months. In the first corporate IIP conference, which was held in Indore in April 2019, this state received the award for the best state IIP Women's Health. Let me introduce you to the Satara team of IIP Women's Health, who is organizing this webinar series. The Satara team consists of 3 members, and it was established on 31st of January 2019. Dr. Trupti Yadav as coordinator and assistant professor in Krishna College of Physiotherapy. Myself, Dr. Khushbu Chotai, as sub-coordinator and assistant professor at Krishna College of Physiotherapy. And Dr. Pallavi Kulkarni as sub-coordinator. As the webinar is jointly organized by Krishna College of Physiotherapy, I fail in my responsibilities if I do not introduce Krishna Institute of Medical Sciences, deemed to be University Kharar. It was established by the visionary founder, chairman, and honorable chancellor, late Sri Jaiwant Rauji Bhosle, our beloved Appa Sir. Also, presently it is flourishing under the guidance of honorable chancellor, Dr. Suresh Bhosle, Honorable Pro-Chancellor, Dr. Praveen Shingare, Honorable Principal Advisor, Dr. Ved Prakash Mishra, Honorable Vice-Chancellor, Dr. Mrs. Neelam Mishra, and respected Registrar, Dr. M.B. Ghorpade. University currently has undergraduate, postgraduate, and super specializations in many facilities like medical, dental, physiotherapy, nursing, allied health, and pharmacy. It is also host to 5,000 plus students on the environmental friendly campus. It has NABH, NABL, ISO, NIRF, NAC-A accreditations to its credit. The university has excellent facilities for housing students on campus with state-of-art sports complex. College of Physiotherapy initially started under MUHS in 2002, and it achieved its deemed status in 2005-06. Currently, it has undergraduate, postgraduate, and interdisciplinary PhD program. College is headed by Dr. D. G. Vardurajulu from its inception. Krishna College of Physiotherapy is a pioneer institute in Maharashtra with all the facilities as per the norms of IIP and Maharashtra State OTPT Council. I would now request Dr. G. Vardurajulu, sir, to kindly introduce our speaker.
Very good afternoon, one and all, and warm welcome to all of you for this third lecture on this webinar series by Dr. Snehal Deshpande, madam. on behalf of the Krishna Institute of Medical Sciences, deemed to be university, and Indian Association of Physiotherapy, Women's Health of Maharashtra, Satara District, we wholeheartedly welcome Dr. Snehal Deshpande Madam for delivering her lecture on toolkit for developmental assessment of developmental milestones. So regarding Madam, actually does not require any kind of introduction. She is well known for her fashion of working in Maharashtra. In fact, the whole India knows her very well. Still, Madam is a certification along with being a physiotherapist. She is a certified NDT practitioner, Therabed instructor, and she has got a postgraduate diploma in healthcare and hospital management in her crown, and other certifications like taping, myofascial, gait, orthosis, Davies learning strategies, etc. Madam generally believes in evidence-based practices and conducts workshops and camps to spread her knowledge to students and professionals on various topics. Dr. Snehal Deshpande Madam has received many national and international awards. She has memberships in various associations also. She is a director of Wellness CME Artfulness. She is a pediatric physiotherapist dealing with physically challenged, hyperactive, and autistic kids with an experience of more than 30 plus years. Dr. Snehal Deshpande Madam believes in giving back to the society in the best possible way that she can. Your clarity and compassion are outstanding, and we take a real privilege to welcome you, Madam. Thank you very much. We wholeheartedly welcome you for joining this lecture, Madam. Over to you, Madam.
Thank you. A big thank you to every one of you, the IP Women's Cell from Satara, Karad College of Physiotherapy, Dr. Varadarajalu and Dr. Mandar and the staff. So the topic given to me was assessment of developmental delay. So we had a nice punch to it, and we gave it, we're offering you a toolkit so that when you go back, you have some tools with you, which will enable you to assess a child who comes to you. Can I share my screen? Is it okay with you all? Yeah?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it visible?
Yeah? Yes, it's visible, ma'am.
The talk for today is toolkit. Why is it getting paused? It's showing that it is getting paused. Being your share window, resume share. Is it being seen or no?
Ma'am, it is visible.
It's visible, madam.
Yeah, okay. So the talk for today is toolkit for developmental delays. And yes, by profession, I'm a developmental therapist. I call myself that, because I started way back in 1990 as a physiotherapist. We started, that time there was no organized NDT, SI. We used to give therapy as we had learned with experience. And courses, you know, the certified courses came much later on. I walked the way in B.J. Vadia Hospital for Children, honed skills for sensory integration, and also connections and attachment therapy. I'm also by profession a life coach now. That is an additional qualification which has come unto me. So welcome to the world of pediatric physiotherapy. If at any point you all don't see the slides, just let me know. Welcome to the world of pediatric physiotherapy. So when you think of pediatric physiotherapy, the first thought which comes to us as professionals is a CP child. So when I started my career, the children who used to come to us were all with polio, with calipers, and with shoes which were not very, we can't see the next slide. That's what is written. I have no clue why is it happening. Resume share, stop share. I'll just share again and see. Okay, again it is not. Okay, let's go this way. This is seen, right? Well, welcome to the world of pediatric physiotherapy.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah. the moment I go into the whole screen, it is not shared. That's what happens. The notice comes up that it is not being shared. I don't know why this is happening. So see this, and it is not shared because the next slide won't be seen. I've gone to the next slide and it is not seen. So stop share. The first time this is happening, because never this has happened up to now till morning.
We'll not keep the full screen. I think that should be fine.
Yeah, that should be fine, right?
Yes.
So welcome to the world of pediatric physiotherapy. And as I said, initially we used to see children who came to us with PPRP, post polio residual paralysis, and of course cerebral palsy. So many of the physiotherapists who passed out that time did not want to take up pediatric physiotherapy as a profession. Very frankly speaking, now when you see pediatric physiotherapy and particularly the neuro rehabilitation, it is a very attractive profession and a very happy profession. I can say that. I feel very happy that I'm a pediatric physiotherapist. Going on to a next slide. So what do you mean by a toolkit? When we say that we are going to...
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt. You will have to just share the screen. I think that is not visible.
Is it?
Yes, ma'am.
There is something happening.
We are extremely sorry for...
Now?
Yes, ma'am. It's visible.
No. Because it's going... I think it's live, so that's the reason. It is saying that bring your shared window to the front. How do I do that?
Ma'am, we'll go to your previous... not the full screen?
Yeah, now it is seen. I think
okay.
It is seen. Yeah.
Okay.
So what is a toolkit? When a child starts playing and you see that he has a lot of tools in his hands, he actually starts exploring the environment. He goes to the kitchen, he pulls out the tools from the kitchen and says, oh, this is something new which I saw. So as a pediatric physiotherapist, let us see what are the different tools what enable us to look at the development or the developmental delay in the child. So what do people think that we as pediatric physiotherapists do? So when I joined in the year 1988, they used to give passive stretches, they used to give infrared heat, and they used to give massage. So that was a form of pediatric therapy, and many people still believe that pediatric therapy means all these things. Notably not so. We have a lot of fun. We have a lot of interaction. We enable the families and the clients who come to us to look at a beautiful life which lies in front of them. Life is colorful for us as pediatric physiotherapists. So if you see here, we are looking at a case, a child who had come to me with cerebral palsy. We are looking at a child who has oromotor problems or orosensory problems. So we do a lot of, you know, eating. So feeding disabilities, children with feeding disabilities do come to us. And this is the best part which I like, that is the field of neonatal care. The more early a child comes to us, the better is the quality of life for that child. We also do a lot of gait training. You can see we have a pediatric treadmill here. The orthoses what we choose for a child are very, very different than what used to be given initially. So there's a whole orthotic management program, and children with sensory processing disorders and syndromes are seen by us. So these are the different conditions for which children come to us. Autism spectrum, you have learning disabilities, developmental coordination disorders, you have club feet, the orthopedic issues. It can be starting from torticollis to your spinal issues, spina bifida, to feet issues, flat feet, CTEV. You can have anything to do with the peripheral nervous system like GPS, etc. Children do come to us when they need fitness and they need sports rehabilitation. We also do post-surgical interventions. We see children with ADHD, ADD, autism. We see children who come to us with low birth weight, developmental delay, or developmental delay without any particular reason, premature children, and children who have a neurological insult. So when you see a broad spectrum, we cannot limit ourselves and say, okay, there is developmental delay which the child has. Needless to say, all the children do have a developmental delay, but the path for us to go is either we just do a normal neurological assessment, which we are taught in the college level, that is a neurological assessment, or we go the fun way, which is looking at the participation and the function of the child in society. it's very important that our evaluation or assessment or our toolkit gives us necessary decision making capabilities. And why is that essential? Because based on our decisions, the family decides what has to be done in future. See, one thing we have to clearly understand that this family has come to us after going to many people, to the orthopedic surgeon, to the neurophysician, to the pediatrician, and then they walk into our centers thinking that there may be succor or there may be help which may be available here. So it is time for us to change, and we need not do just a cursory evaluation what we were taught. We have to do something different. We no longer follow the floppy disks. We have so many good music systems. So it's time to us for us to change even in our outlook towards evaluation. So the type of cases which we see. You see this first one. Now this child had come to us with a history of developmental delay. You can see she is playing very well. Unassumingly, you will feel she's an active child. But if you look very closely, you will see that the movements which the child does have a little bit of a tremulousness, little bit, not much. She has a little bit of a broad base. There's a little paucity of movement as compared to what an 8-month-old child should do. So needless to say, she's come to us with TD, that is developmental delay. Okay, I'll come later to you what happened to that child and what is the diagnosis. You can see that, you can see the tongue coming out. You say, oh, oral issues hai, low tone hai. I think you all can type in the chat box, what do you feel would be the diagnosis of this little child here. Let us see what you'll type. So this is our little baby. Then this is another child who recently came to us in the time of lockdown. We will shut this video. We'll start this one. The permission for the videos have been taken, so our parents have been good enough, gracious enough. This is a spot diagnosis for all of you. You can see the chest wall retraction. You can see the belly breathing. So again, another child who comes to you, the families who come to you with such a child, and they are following up every single day almost. Now, this is one case which I want to bring to your notice. This child came to us in August 2009 with a history of developmental delay again, and I'll come to his entire history in some time. So he is now almost 2 years old. When we had this case done, he was 15 months. He was referred to us by a pediatric neurologist. Chief complaints: delayed gross motor, fine motor, social communication skills. Keeps looking up. Up means looking at lights. He does not show any separation anxiety. He is good with anyone and keeps moving his legs in a cyclic movement. He did not roll. He did not crawl. He did not come up to sit when he had come to us. The history which he had was he cried immediately. Birth weight was 2.9. No NICU stay. Discharge on third day. Apgar was not known. He had formula milk since day one for 2 to 3 months as he could not latch properly. In the process, he lost 500 grams post-delivery. At 9 months of age, they visited their pediatrician, and then the neurophysician was advised all the investigations. They took therapy for 3 months in Hinduja, and then they came to us after that. Maybe he was around 8 to 9 months. With therapy, he started showing a progress. Okay, so this is what happened. Post-therapy, he started rolling. He started coming up to crawl. So there was definitely a sort of a change which was seen, but I was not happy. I felt that we were looking at something different. So I asked them to again visit the neurophysician and do a test. And yet this is yesterday's picture, what you're seeing on the left, this one. So he turned out to be a loss of chromosome 8. Now, why I wanted to bring this case to you all is every child who comes to us with a tag of developmental delay should not be tagged as a case of cerebral palsy. We have a most important tool. And what is that most important tool? Can someone tell me? Well, can put it on the chat box if you can. Or just think back. If you don't want to write, just think what is the most important tool you have as a physiotherapist? Anyone? Observation, very good. Yes. So we have our eyes and we have our observation. So scales, assessment, play. So the first important tool is I give full marks to whoever has written observation. We should have the first important tool is what you see and what you see beyond your eyes, what is seen. So the moment a child walks into the clinic, I start observing how the parents are. Are they anxious? Are they having some hesitancy? How is the child with them? Is he sharing a natural relationship or there is some anxiety in the relationship? So start reading the signs. How is he carried? So the way a parent carries the child gives you a lot of information. Suppose the child is floppy, the feet will be dangling down. If he's very tight, he'll be clinging. If he has a sensory processing disorder, he'll be crying. So there are a lot of signs you can start jotting down or making a mental note as soon as the child walks in with the parents. You immediately come to know who is the decision-making person in those two. Or if the grandmother, grandfather tag along, you can make out, oh no, they are depending on the grandparents for their decision. Now, these are important factors for you all as therapists, for us as therapists, to understand where to put the key, where to unlock. If I tell the parents that the child is going to require therapy, which is regular, and they look at each other, the first thing I understand is that the decision is not resting with them. Then they'll tell hum ghar mein pooch ke aapko batate hain. So they have to go back to the grandparents. So when you're giving therapy, these are the factors which count a lot. Okay. So most important, the first one, as you all said, is observation. And the second one is the child. Most important tool, because you're going to observe the child, the observer and the person who is observed. Two most important tools which we have in the process of evaluation. And what the child does is most important for us than what the child does not do. The family comes to us with a complaint that ye mera bachcha chalta nahi hai, mera bachcha baat nahi karta hai. But for us, what is he doing? Is he giving eye contact? Is he trying to connect with you? Is he even taking a few steps? Is he trying to look at you and say, hello, I'm here. So these are important things, what he can do. So observation and the child. Now, what has to be observed? Definitely, as you can see, this is one of our therapist's kid who is sitting there very royally like a princess. So how is she participating? Is she interested? Is she really, really looking at participation or she is forced to participate? How is the function? So after participation comes function. Third comes the emotions, and associated with the emotions come the behavior. So these are the four major things you have to assess when a child comes to you or the family brings the child to you. Why? Because any theory which you see, the motor learning theory as you see, is that any task or any participation, what you see depends on three factors, T, I, and E, the task, the individual, and the environment. These are the three important factors. So it is the child who is observed. What is the task the child is doing? Where is he performing the task? Very often so, when the child comes to the clinic, he does not show you the exact picture what he would have shown at home because this is a new place for him. Needless to say, we as therapists make an assessment into a structure which is not natural for that child. It is very essential that you all tell the parents to get his videos from home in a natural way of participation. What is important for a child? What is important? It is his play, his relationships, a sense of security, a sense of comfort. These are little things which matter to the child the most. and understand, unlike a pediatrician who just gives a prick to the child for vaccination or just talks to the parents, the child is going to be with the pediatric physiotherapist for more than an hour or so. So his security, his sense of satisfaction, his interaction should be given priority. That has to be given priority. So what is important for us to know? What stage of we are definitely talking of developmental delay. So the third toolkit for y'all is understanding what are typical ages and stages of the child's development. Needless to say, we'll say batteries, assessment scales, all that is fine. We are therapists. We look at how the child performs the moment, how the child participates, how the child functions. It is not like others who see the child sitting and grade the milestones. We are not here to grade milestones. We are here to grade how the child is achieving the milestones. The quality of the muscle contraction, the quality of the child's participation is what determines the development for us as therapists. So doctors, when they refer to the child to us, they'll say, go to them, wo aapka theek karenge. Aap unke paas jao, aap achha ho jayenge. So they want, what they want is very good results. And they ensure the parents ki therapy se bachcha theek ho jayega. I think one slide is missing in this, where I say that the parents expect the child to be excelling in all the fields. The therapist most often looks at the strength and the range of motion. But the child definitely wants to play, definitely wants function. He says, please look at my function. So who approaches us? Very important question. Many a times nowadays in the field of neurotherapy or neurophysiotherapy, we have been approached by clients themselves. So I have adult patients who have different issues. It could be sensory processing disorders. It could be cerebral palsy. It could be any other problem coming to us. The parents can bring the child to us. The schools can approach us. The orphanages, Anganwadi workers can approach us. So it is very essential, again, when you're looking at your toolkit, you have to understand who is approaching you. And why is that important? Because everyone has their own sort of agenda. The school wants to know what has to be done, what are the goals to be set. So if you're looking at a school, then your toolkit will be different as opposed to looking at an orphanage or maybe a caregiver who is getting the child to you. And if the adult is walking in by himself or herself, then the goals are different. There have been cases who have come to me and said, a 26-year-old man who was working for a very good firm came and told me, I cannot sit in a place. I cannot. He had a first-class career. He was an MBA with a first-class career. He said, I keep twiddling my thumbs, breaking my pencils. When there's a boardroom meeting, I go on banging the table. There is something which is wrong with me. I cannot actually go on with my relationships for a long time. He had been to several psychiatrists, and then one of the psychiatrists thought of referring him to me. And it was my first case of sensory integration or sensory processing disorder in an adult, in adulthood. So when I saw him, I said, I didn't know what to do, because it's the first time I was looking at someone who's come to me. It can happen. You can just get a case whom you have never come across. And I said, now what do I do? So I did a adult sensory profile. I did a complete history. And that's where I want to tell you all that your history taking is very important. What is the daily lifestyle? What is the child doing or the adult doing? With whom does he come across? How is his interaction with them? Where are the problems which he is making out? So I did an entire checkup and I found out that his vestibular system was the one which was affected. And he was a preterm child, but jaise India mein hota hai ki we go on waiting for the development to come by itself. Things went on. Luckily, cognitively, he was spared. He had a wonderful career. But he had sensory issues right from the beginning. With therapy, I told him, see, I'll put you on a swing. You please pardon me for doing this. I've never handled an adult with SI. So I put him on the swing. The first day he froze. And I knew I was in the right direction. We walked the way for 6 months. He went back to his job very successful. So this is, and he got married after that. So this is the way you have to think, who is approaching you is important, because why they are coming to you will be defining the agenda of what you have to give to them. Again, it is very, very important to understand that the, for the child, what is important? It is not standing. It is not sitting. It is that intrinsic motivation. Why am I doing it? Why am I supposed to play with those toys? Why am I supposed to pretend play? Or even for a child who is GMFCS level 5, little joys in life for him create that motivation. So again, what are the factors which create motivation in the child? So here we look at the likes, the dislikes, the moments of fear and moments of happiness. Very, very important points to understand. Now here, coming to our most important thing. Do we have a pediatric way of assessing range of motion? Yes. So this is a pediatric kit which was given to me thanks to Beverly Cusick's workshop which we had attended on pediatric orthopedics. These are the different ages in which the ranges change. So pediatric range of motion is much different from the adult range of motion. This is again, I've given the reference of this paper in this. The pediatric way of doing muscle charting is also very different as compared to do the adult way of muscle charting. Looking at the sensory, someone asked me for scales. We do have a lot of scales. When you look at sensory profiles, sensory systems, we follow the sensory profiles, the SP2, and all these are there. There are 8 of them. Okay, we have to understand according to the ages, there are sensory profiles which are defined. And for looking at the sensory integration praxis test, we have the SIPIT. So this is the battery of your sensory toolkits. When you come to babies, we have n number of assessment scales. But again, the first assessment scale, I would say, is assessment of the child's behavior. So you have the HINT, Harris Infant's Neuromotor Test. You have the test of infant motor performance. Many people follow the general movements. IMPS, this is something which I've recently started following. So there are a lot of tools and scales which are available. Coming to my case 2. Now this child had come to us again few days back. These are all the lockdown cases. And we are doing online consultations for a lot of kids. So he's from Indore. The parents had come to the neurophysician. Again with a history of cerebral palsy, but with a seizure disorder. Okay, this child has a seizure disorder. And again, when I asked the type of therapy given, which was given to him, there was passive physiotherapy. Needless to say, within one session of interaction, I assessed his mother's level of understanding. She's amazing. She's amazing as a mother. It's so important to have a caregiver who is so understanding. What I want to point out here when I'm coming to this case is when you have a case with developmental delay, who's having a diagnosis of cerebral palsy, with a seizure disorder, try to understand what is causing the seizures. You just can't write their CP with seizure disorder and start treating. Understanding the causes of the seizure, what drives the seizure, what eliminates the seizure, all this becomes very important for us as therapists. So why is finding a cause important? The family gains the understanding of the condition, including the prognosis. We don't have to say for every child who comes to us, theek ho jayega, 6 mahine mein theek ho jayega. No, you have to set realistic expectations to the family. You lessen the parental blame. So many of the times in India especially, a lot of blame is put on the parents. It is because of you all that this child is like this. So when you find the cause, this lessens the parental blame. Third, it prevents comorbidity by identifying factors likely to cause secondary disability that are potentially preventable. Fourth, you can also give appropriate genetic counseling for recurrence risk for future children and wider families and the wider family. So other family members who could be affected. And five, accessing more support within the education services and specific syndrome support groups. That is to address concerns about possible causes, that is examples, events during pregnancy and delivery. So many kids who come to us now, because there has been so much amount of genetic testing which is happening, metagenome has come into picture. There are a lot of syndromes which are being picked up, chromosomal abnormalities. So once you see that the child has something which is different and no cause, like what you saw in case one, there was no cause to point out that the child has cerebral palsy, but it came out to you as a developmental delay. Now, this is our third child. She came to us maybe another few months back again. She had a very mild developmental delay, smiling, motivated, very interactive, supportive family, but she had little jerks. She would just blink. So she had a little bit of a jerky movement which was coming. She had a little tremulousness. You can see she cannot maintain her balance as she is climbing up. So she was another case whom we referred to the neurophysician, and her diagnosis is something different. We are awaiting her diagnosis still, but she is low tone with a seizure disorder. So all children who come to you with a seizure disorder can have distributions of tone which can be different. So low tone, delayed milestones with seizures. So if you're looking at cerebral palsy, now coming to the condition which most commonly comes to all of us, which is cerebral palsy. What is the natural progression? Acquisition of all the motor skills are delayed, unquestionably. The trajectory of early mobility is but classifiable. How? We use a GMFCS-5, which is a 5-point scale. All of us know that. Function improves up to 7 years. I've seen that. Function improves with therapy, without therapy, very slowly, but little improvement is seen. But what happens at 7? The same parents who had come to you up to 7 years, very beautifully, when the child comes to preteens, which is supposed to be 8 years now, start thinking twice, should I follow up with therapy or should I not? The reason being, it levels off between 10 to 15. Why? A lot of things happen between 10 to 15. There's a sudden growth spurt which comes into picture. Second, the hormonal problems come into picture. So there is a sort of a conflict which is happening internally and externally, which is reflected in their performance. Parents become tired and they feel, arre ye to theek hi nahi ho raha hai. What happens after 25? Now I am seeing kids who are 25, 30 years in, after so many years of practice, who are doing well, provided that they have been followed up with goals in life which have been set for them. Coming to the tone affections in cerebral palsy, we have to understand that there are two types when you're looking at hypertonia. You have to look at the neurological tone and a tone which is because of the rheological properties. I mean, looking at hypertonia, even if you sit with your shrugged shoulders for some time, you definitely increase postural tone. Many times, kids have hypomobility, kids have hypoextensibility, kids have tightness, and kids have thixotropy. Now, what do you mean by thixotropy? It means that if you, suppose there is a paint, your house is undergoing painting and there's a paint box which is kept onto one side, the paint layer thickens. The moment you put the brush inside or maybe a knife inside, you find that the paint inside is still very fluidy or liquidy. So that is the property of viscosity. Any structure which is in the body, which is basically facial structures, undergo this sort of stiffness when they are not moved for a long time. All of you all may have known that during this process of lockdown, when you all don't, when you have not got the opportunity to move, even you feel a little stiff in your body. That is thixotropy. So all your rigidity, spasticity, and dystonia come under one umbrella, which are pathological. This may or may not be pathological. Come under the umbrella or funnel of hypertonia. So when you're thinking of an assessment, selection is more important than the injections, whether it is Botox, whether it is surgery. You have to select, and that's where your evaluation or assessment will give your path to. Now, what is a developmental delay? There are a group of conditions due to impairments in physical, learning, language, or behavior areas. These conditions begin during the developmental period and may impact day-to-day functioning and usually last through a person's lifetime. This is the source of the definition. I won't go into the second one. Significant delay of at least 2 standard deviations in at least 2 or more developmental categories, gross motor, fine motor, speech, cognition, social, personal, on Denver developmental scale. So what is the prevalence? 5 to 10% of childhood population and most children with GDD have impairment on all domains. That is the reference again for you all. This is the Indian scenario, causes of developmental delay. You can see Down syndrome, maternal deprivation, visual impairment, prematurity, birth asphyxia, protein energy malnutrition, 3% of post-encephalitis. The hearing impairment is becoming a lot common nowadays. Though that 3% is seen, we are getting a lot of children who are undergoing, coming to us with cochlear implants, coming for assessments, pre-cochlear implant, post-cochlear implant. children with visual impairment coming to us for visual rehabilitation. So all these sections are coming to us. It's not only cases with cerebral palsy. So these are case things which you'll know. I'll not go into details. The etiology of delayed development or developmental disability could be cerebral dysgenesis. Any child who is dysmorphic, malformed, abnormal shape of the head, HIE, all of us know cerebral palsy, any history of toxins, chromosomal anomalies, any syndromes like Fragile X, Rett syndrome. Again, this is an etiologic yield of young children with global developmental delay. It is seen that, you can see it here, 20%. Then you have HIE, again 20%. You have toxins, about 20%. Then goes out to chromosomal anomalies. Your genetic syndromes come here. No, genetic syndromes is the next. Then is neuromuscular, neurocutaneous, congenital infections, psychological conditions, sensory impairments, and metabolic disorders. So this is what we got out of reading from the journals. The other conditions can be the neuromuscular disorders, congenital infections, and psychosocial problems, sensory impairments, and metabolic disorders. So you can see in this sequence, we have covered all whatever will come to you on paper, may it be rubella, may it be seizures, may it be any sensory affections, impairments, anything. It could be a neural transmitter disorder. So these are the risk factors which are which cause a developmental delay, which could be prenatal, it could be exogenous, it could be in relation to the social context. So perinatal could be prematurity, prenatal alcohol, social deprivation, brain injury, micronutrient deficiencies, very important and cropping up nowadays because of lifestyle, exogenous exposures like environmental toxins, and social context is all what we know, needless to say. So what do? We definitely do. We need the history. We need the pre, perinatal, postnatal, and family history. In maternal history, ask everything, everything possible, right from what her health was, how were the child movements, or fetal movements, any tests done in the perinatal mode of delivery, Apgar scores, birth weight, length, head circumference, feeding, muscle tone, other problems, and your postnatal history. So this history, we at SNIA take in great detail. We take the family history of three generations, what is happening on both the sides, any history of birth defects, childhood defects, mental retardation, etc. So these are the potential problems in development which can happen. Movement, problems with muscle power, control and coordination. All of us know that. Communication problems, hearing, vision, physical, oral, causes not known, thinking. That means structural problems in the brain can cause problems with learning, chromosomal delays, genetic defects, etc. Brain damage and hereditary factors. So that is four potential problems in development. And their impact is on all the domains. I need not go into details of everything. It goes into right from relationships to everything. There is an impact which is seen. So identification, as we said, physical examination, looking into parental concerns, using validated screen tools, judicious lab and neuroimaging studies, and referral to EI, to the concerned people. Now looking at when the child comes to you, you immediately see the eyes, you see the head, you see how the eyes, the nose, the ears, these are important factors to be noted. I won't go into great details here, but this is what I see as a therapist. Why? Because I need to understand whether this child is coming to me with a syndrome. Other craniofacial anomalies. Looking at the tone, can be hypertonia, hypotonia. Looking at the shape of the head, looking at the spine. So these are all observations you see when a child comes to you. Look at for signs for autism. That is, if the child is not giving eye contact, he's in his own world, he sort of lines things, if there's a repeated behavior. So look out for these signs. You can give the parent a ASQ, that is ages and stages questionnaire, which can be given to him. You can give many of these questionnaires which are there, and we do follow them at SNIA. So parent completed screening can be given to them. Now post screening, what happens? You administer a developmental screening tool. If it is positive, then definitely take immediate actions. If it is not positive, then you look at parental concern for the delay. Yes, you discuss, go on to another interval, discuss with their other team members, continued concern, give therapy, or look at giving guidance. So this is a process of screening which has been described. Now these are various points which come in the which come into picture when you think of when do you look at the first line of investigations, what is the second line of investigations, and the third line of investigations. So if you're working with a neurophysician who goes step by step, you will automatically know how this follows. When do you ask for an EEG? When do you ask for an MRI? When do you ask for urine tests, blood tests? There are other things, telomeres, microarrays, Angelman's, Prader-Willi. So all these are various things what you would ask for in a case of developmental delay. Then you're looking at comprehensive medical evaluation. You're looking at diagnostic developmental evaluation, early interventions, that is speech. So when you're looking at the team which you want to work with, it can either be a definite developmental pediatrician, it could be a neurophysician, it could be a psychologist, occupational therapist, or any other person who can positively impact your child's life. Coming to our most important and favorite therapy, which is sensory integration therapy. All of us know the child has 7 senses which he feels and experiences his world. So every person is different in the way they use the sensory information. It is for them to make meaning out of this. What is overstimulating for one person may not be for another person. It is very important to remember that when young children come to you, they're very, very unique in their own way. So the sensory profile is a thumbprint for that child. It won't be the same as a child who comes to you, another child who comes to you. Now, first thing when you see for a sensory assessment is the registration. Can the child register? Can the child detect? Okay, that is registration. Then you see the 4 A's. What are the 4 A's? First is the arousal. That is the child alert? The ability to maintain alertness. Second, attention. Is the child mentally alert? Third is affect. That is the emotional component. And the fifth is action. So these 4 A's you see in both sensory as well as your NDT. Arousal, it can be a highly aroused child crying, throwing a tantrum, or a completely lethargic child like what you see here. Attention, you have to not only see the ability to attain, but also ability to sustain the attention. Look at the emotional component, that is the affect. And we have identified, according to Yilin's emotion chart, so many emotions. Look at the action, which is the fourth and the final tip of your pyramid. Parents come to us for action, but we have to look at arousal, attention, and affect. Before going to action, these are the 3 steps which give rise to action. So if we start our therapy with action, it is not going to yield results, because what we have to look at is arousal, attention, and affect. Now coming to NDT. When you're looking at NDT, again, most important systems, posture and movement, and your multi-systems. Participation function becomes a base. What is the child doing? Is he able to go to school? If he's going to school, how is he going to school? What is coming the way? Is the multi-system coming in the way, or the systems coming in the way, single systems coming in the way? Where is the family from? Are they really interested in therapy? What is their culture? What is the intervention team? And what is the characteristics of the client? So this becomes your focused window when you're having a for assessment in an NDT approach. So what do we do in an NDT approach? When you're looking at posture, you look at alignment, you look at the base of support, and you look at the center of gravity. So A, B, C's of posture is what you look. How does the child maintain the center of mass over the base of support? You can see when even in a typical child, when they play marbles, they shift their base so as to get good function. Last but the most important thing is parents. Now parents with good cope and how they cope up, that's very, very important, because parents with good coping strategies demonstrate better personal well-being, increased involvement, more positive interactions, more positive attitudes. Therefore, they score high on developmental tests. Assessment of the family and how they deal with the child becomes important. And assessment of your program which you give them. It is not only ki I give therapy and end of it, how is my program handled by the family? How am I implementing it? Am I keeping this thing in mind? Am I identifying the developmental delay? Am I identifying the causes of developmental delay? Am I providing information to the parents? Am I putting the child into a developmentally enriching setting? What is it that I'm doing? Am I looking at a multidisciplinary evaluation? So constant evaluation also of your program is a must. And the last and final slide, which I would say, is to watch them grow and to see them integrated in the society with a smile on their face and those of their parents. That's our goal. A parent's way of looking at it, you're suddenly faced with the fact that you haven't got a normal child, and you know it means it's very devastating. At the time you sort out and grieve for this, you think, God, this is going to be, it's going to be a lifelong thing. It's not going to go away. It's not going to get better. She's always going to have cerebral palsy. So this is a parent's view of looking at things. But yes, as therapists, you can always give them hope to watch them grow and see them integrated in a society with a smile. Thank you.
Very nice presentation, madam. Very much informative. And it's really very much useful for the younger generation, for whom you are already a mentor across the state. So very nice presentation. We appreciate your efforts that you have taken, some videos, some assessments, tools that you really, that is being in use, and how simple it is, still we were not aware of. And people generally, those who are interested to practice in neurodevelopmental unit, they should know certain basics. They should build up, then only they can be a better pediatric physiotherapist. Thank you very much, madam. Now I'll hand over the mic to Dr. Mandar Malvade for the questionnaire section.
Any questions, please write down so that I can go through it and I can ask madam. And there is one question. It's how to differentiate hyperactive and the normal child during his initial learning phase or developmental stage, and what are the indications for Botox?
Okay, so it is felt, and most of the kids nowadays are hyperactive. I won't deny with that. I mean, that's a very good statement what she has put. But what do you mean by hyperactivity? By the definition what DSM-5 gives you, you have to follow that definition very clearly. The child is not able to sit in a particular place for a long time, for a span of 6 months. So if the hyperactivity is coming in the way of his participation and function, and the parents cannot do anything about that, then you call the child attention deficit. He's not able to keep his things in a place. He keeps fidgeting. So there is a criteria which has been defined by DSM-5 now, not 4. DSM-5, look out for that and keep that very handy and valuable with you. Looking at what are the indications for Botox, as I said, selection is more important than the injection. When you think of Botox, first look at what cognitively, one, assessment, how good the child is. Second, is the spasticity coming, really, really coming in the way of his participation and function? Recently, when we have attended the conference in American Academy and Cerebral Palsy and Developmental Medicine in US of A in 2019, use of Botox now is very limited. They don't use Botox as much as they used to do earlier. So we have to be really very cautious with the way in which we are handling Botox. Only when there is a need, the child is really going on toes and you cannot do anything. Now again, assess child going on toes, could be sensory, could be motor. If it is sensory, then treat the sensory cause. If it is motor, look at how you can work with the child by giving myofascial release, by giving participation. Still nothing is happening for a span of 2-3 months and he's really going on toes again and it is coming in way of the function, then go on to Botox. So keep a very functional goal, going on toes, not coming out. It's just too tight, or the perineal hygiene is not happening in GMFCS5. So keep, we have given Botox for torticollis because the child used to have in dystonic children. So child used to have this extensive thrust at around 7 to 8 months the child was in Wadia, and we have given Botox for that child. So if nothing can be done and you have no resource, then go ahead. In fact, it has to be held hand in hand. The ability of the child, of the family, to come for therapy post Botox has to be assessed, because it is not enough to give the injection. It's going to paralyze the muscle. After that, you need a good rehabilitation protocol to be followed. The child has to be given good splints, orthosis. So compliance of the family towards the rehab program also needs to be assessed. That's what I would say for Botox.
There is another question related to work with children with special needs. Do we need to be registered with RCI according to Mental Health Act?
The RCI is a completely different thing, and I think our profession is completely different thing. So suppose you want to start into mental health and into other things, and RCI, I don't know. I mean, I don't think it is required for us, but definitely a psychological. There are many therapists who jump into RCI. See, in India, there is no body, as I can say, which is a consulting body for, or a counsel for us to give us a registration for rehabilitation. So I would say it depends on you, how you want to take it. It's open to you all. I mean, you all know better than me in this.
This is one question, ma'am, which is very, very important. I feel very important. Is it how to get infants, they're still 1 year of age, to pay attention or concentrate? And the attachment to that is how also to arouse the kid. As many therapists have complained that the kids sleep after coming to the physiotherapy clinics.
Manda sir, just to interrupt, we'll take this as the last question as we are running short of time.
So my name has been now christened as the baby whisperer by my daughter's friends, because I talk to babies very well. Talking to babies is an art, and you have to really connect with them. How to connect with them? Eye contact, get them close and feel the connection. Nothing else is required. See, what are the systems which are the best in early infancy? Touch. They need a good touch. They need a good eye contact. They need the positive vibes. You cannot be insecure when you're taking a baby. They will never behave well with you. So if you're secured, if you're smiling, if you're joyful, definitely with an eye contact, you get everything done with. In fact, I really work well with babies. I'm very happy with them around. And what is the second part of the question? If they go to sleep, then you're doing something which is causing a sensory shutdown. Be careful of it. Or they could be coming in an auto. See, many times the kids come in an auto. They travel a long distance. They do have a vestibular problem. So if that is happening on and on, just ask the parents to come a little early. Maybe let the child settle down. Give a little water to the child. Not that the child is walking into the therapy room. Come, settle down, and then take the child for therapy. Look if the sensory cause is there, or our cause is there. Are we putting the child into a sensory shutdown? These are two things which I would say.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Dr. Pruthi, 1 minute. Dr. Khushbu, 1 minute. I would like to take your suggestion and opinion on whether shall we build up a community model of NDT approach, madam, so that, because nowadays in Satara, in nearby places, there are a number of CP homes are there, where we get a different age group of patients. So generally they don't get the complete physio care as that in the, how they come and take in our department or at your center or different new NDT units and all, they cannot go. So because we being a deemed university and you being the private organization, so shall we have a collaborative, shall we prepare a collaborative community model of NDT approach, where we can take the entire approach to the non-unreachable people?
I think that'll be really amazing. See, with Dr. Anaita, we are covering Dhule and we are covering Nanded already. So, and we are very happy to do those services. We are doing it for the last 8 to 9 years. So definitely, and Satara, we had come, I think way back also, Kolhapur, Sangli, Satara, that we had covered. After that, the same thing, the orthopedic surgeons and neurophysicians wanted to do something collaborative, but then things didn't materialize. Definitely,
we are having a tie-up with 2-3 CP homes around this place. There, who are really in need of such kind of approach.
Definitely. Anytime training, I'm very happy to participate.
Togetherly, we'll prepare a community model. We'll take your guidelines on that and we'll try to implement it, madam. We'll
sure. This,
I feel. Sure, sure. Yeah. Thank you.
So can we have the vote of thanks?
Madam, with the sense of gratitude, it's my pleasure and privilege to give you the heartfelt thanks to your contribution on this webinar series. And on behalf of the university, on behalf of the IAP, once again, thank you very much, madam, for your valuable time that you have given.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So much.
Thank you, madam.